I'm live. Holy smokes. Who is out there? Anyone? What's up? Anybody on? Oh, we got three. Somebody give me a sound check out there. Am I on the sound check? Are we ready to go? I'm ready. I'm willing. I may not be able, but I'm ready. Ethan Baxter, what's up? How's it sound? Do we sound good, Ethan? Can you hear me? Maybe that's not good if you can hear me, actually. But, man, it is hot today. Holy smoke. It was extremely warm today. And what I did today was I decided that we should hike. I mean, you should hike when it's hot. I mean, I'm not saying everybody should hike. I have to, though. I mean, I have to do this because we go out regardless of what the weather's like. I mean, it doesn't matter. So, man, if you are going out in it and you are in Phoenix, Arizona, then, man, make sure that you are prepared to go out when you go out to hike today. And, man, I tell you what, it's hiking in the heat is just different. So, you know, that's the thing about it. So I'm going to, you know, wait. We got all kinds of stuff going on today. I mean, I've got my book here. Can you read that? Yeah. And I've been reading this book and I've been studying this book. And Mr. Steve Lyons asked the other day when he was eating a burrito, where was I at? And I had my nose in this book and I have been studying this book. And man, I'm telling you what, it's some incredible information, but it is not what you would call a novel by no means. It is pretty, it's interesting as hell, but it's so dry. What's up, Ancient Exploring? What's up? What's going on today? I hope everybody's ready to get this thing going today. 90 minutes of action-packed. Well, now action-packed it'll be, but we'll do what we can do to see what's going on. We got 9 people on. What the hell is going on today? It is officially summer in the Valley of the Sun, and there's a pretty damn good reason they call it the Valley of the Sun today. Was it terrible? About 106. Definitely needed to change a little bit of the process before you go out in this. The average person may not want to go out in this. Man, I'm not going to tell you that would be a bad, bad thing. So I'll start this story while we're getting people to crank up and get on. We got a ton of them to get here. A buddy of mine, he's a pretty good hiker. I wouldn't say he doesn't go out every day, but he hikes, I'm going to say 4 or 5 times a week, goes out for hour 30, something like that. And I would say, you know, that most places, if we were hiking, that, you know, I don't know too many places he would have trouble. He's strong. And he was telling me last night, he said, dude, he duded me. He said, dude. And so, you know, it's serious when you get duded. And he's like, I thought I was going to die the other day. I said, well, what the hell did you do? He goes, well, man, I went out at 2 o'clock. And see, a lot of people go, oh, 2 o'clock. I'm going, yeah, that's the perfect time to go out. That's when you go out, when it's the hottest, because if you're training for it. Well, he really wasn't training for it. And so here's a guy that's in good shape, you know, non-smoker. Physically, I would say, man, probably 80 percentile. I mean, it pretty good. Hari, what's up, San Diego? So he goes out and he tells me that he almost dies. And we don't want that. I mean, we don't want any deaths. That's not what we're here about. We're trying to get more followers, not lose any. But he got into what people get into when they hike heat and they don't prep their body. You have, if you're going to do this, first off, I suggest most people, you probably shouldn't do it. Or if you're going to do it, get out at about, you know, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, get out early, regardless of where you're at in the country. I mean, I'm from Kansas City, and even there, a 98 degrees is 98% humidity. I mean, you start sweating. Neil McNabb, let's get it on. Let's do this deal. So if you're going to hike, though, try to get it done early. You know, that's the first thing. And what I do is I try to prep my body, right? I try to get a lot of liquids in me before I go. And I'm not talking about right before I go to the trail. I'm talking about if I know I'm going out and I have the time, I start loading up with water and other substances, electrolytes, Gatorades before an hour to an hour and a half before I go. And what I found out is, Maria, hold up. Brian, what's up? There goes the neighborhood. So I try to get prepared before, right? Before I get ready to go. So what I found out was it kind of lubes my body up. I mean, my joints and stuff like that. So when I go out, man, I'm better prepared. And that's a good thing to do, even if you're not going to go out in 106 degrees like today. But anyway, Brian was out at 2 o'clock, and here's a guy that hikes pretty regularly, you know, good shape. And what happens to him? Man, he says, I got lightheaded. And he started to have what I would, Edward, what's up? Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. So he gets lightheaded. And you know what he told me was the first thing that that hit him was he had this fear that he wasn't going to be able to make it back to the car. And we've talked about that. If you let that fear in your head, man, that's the first step of you being screwed. If you let that come in. Paul, what's up? So the first thing that happened was he got overheated, right? And when you get overheated, the first thing that goes is your thinking, your calmness, right? You get into maybe a little panic mode. And then what happens is your brain says you're in trouble. And if your brain says you're in trouble, then you're in trouble. And so what happened to him was that, you know, then all of a sudden, Manny lost his confidence. And then all of a sudden, here he is. He's in a place where, and we're talking about South Mountain. We're not talking about he wasn't in the middle of nowhere. I mean, you can get pretty far out in South Mountain, but you're still within phone distance. I'll put it that way. But, you know, he told me, he goes, man, my brain, I wasn't thinking right. And that's the first sign that you're starting to get some type of heat stroke, is all of a sudden you start making, fear comes in and you start making some really bad decisions. Tickle the thumbs up would be awesome, Brian. I appreciate that. But so your mind goes, right? And then your confidence goes. And then when that starts to happen, then, man, you can get in real, real trouble, even in a local place, whether it even be Camelback. So make sure that, first off, what I thought happened to him was he's lost the sodium. I said, were you out of water? No, I wasn't out of water. So all of a sudden he lost the sodium. And a lot of you older guys out there remember, if you played any sports, you know, the salt tablets. And that was the reason for those salt tablets, to keep that sodium up, because that's what happened to me. You've seen the video of when I almost died. And so what happened was I lost the sodium in my body. And that's after hiking hard for 3 years. That wasn't somebody new. So if you're going to go out in this, the first thing I suggest is you go slow, right? And that's exactly right as well, Hari. That is a great point. One thing that I do if I'm out there, right, is the first thing I do, I breathe through my nose. Now, this might sound insane, but follow me here. So I start breathing through my nose, and I never breathe through my mouth. I hike breathing through my nose until I get to a place where I can't. And that means I'm not getting enough oxygen. And that's usually on an uphill, right, where I need more oxygen. So my first sign that I'm starting to go down a little bit, and I'm not saying I'm in bad shape, I'm starting to change. I'm starting to need more oxygen. You know, the air is getting thinner. So that's the first thing I do when I have to open my mouth. And another thing I do is when I put my hands on my hips, that means that all of a sudden I'm starting to feel what I'm hiking in, and it's starting to affect me. Doesn't mean I'm close to being done. Hell, I could maybe hike another 7 hours, but it just starts to tell me that my body's starting to change. And so like today, I went up today, it was 106, did about an hour 30 minute hike, and it was all for training. It was all to prepare myself. I got myself set up before I went. I got out of the car and I went, this is going to suck. I said that. So I started off and it was difficult. And then about 30% in, my body adjusted to the heat. I got a pretty good cool breeze. And then all of a sudden, I started to breathe through my nose and I concentrate in what I'm doing. Now that's hard when we go out and shoot the shows. It's extremely difficult. I've never done drinking pickle juice. I've never heard of that. Sounds interesting though. Pickle juice. You know, that always be prepared to be able to find areas, even in, when you're not going out and you know it's a million degrees. Always be prepared. There's a video with Stories by Alex, which is a I love Stories by Alex. I love the guy. And there's one when he's in Gila Bend in the summer and he's out of Cali. And you know, you can tell he's tanked, man. He's had enough. He's on that line. And he got himself into a shelter, got in shade. The problem with the desert, man, is there is not, sometimes there's no shade. Sometimes there's no shelter. So that's what's so, you know, difficult about this is that, you know, you've got to be prepared to be able to deal with this if you're going to do this. Now, what I suggest is, if you don't have to, then don't. You know, if you got to go hike early and be done early. I mean, I do it because I've been doing this forever. And so it's part of the training that I go through just to be able to just stay on top of my game physically wise, because I never know when I'm going to be in a situation where I'm going to need more ability than I have, then I'm going to need a better skill set, because the last thing I want to do is be on a hill sliding down and realize that I've ran out of talent. And that can happen to anybody, and me more than most. So, make sure you're prepared. And again, if you can get out early, you know, the cool thing even here lately is it's still cool in the morning. It's not July yet when it starts to get really hot. So if you get out in that 5 window now, because hell, the sun's up and you can be done at about 11, that's a perfect scenario if you're going to go out in there. Adventures with Pappy, Don't Fence Me Out, is here. Welcome. I'm glad everybody's here. This is awesome. We got the crew going. That is a key thing also. If you are halfway through your water, you're done. You're done with your hike. I mean, you're done with it. Because usually I say if you're 40% done with your water. And so because it's going to be more difficult 9 times out of 10 getting back. You know, the other day I was on a summit and it was straight up and it was tough. I'm not going to say it wasn't tough, but it was 20 times harder coming down that incline. And my front of my legs were on fire for 2 days. And so, you know, you think a lot of times actually going up's the easy way, especially in this climate, in this area, in the way the terrain's based, it's a hell of a lot easier going up than it is down. And I'm going to fall 9 times out of 10. If I fall, it's coming down. Because, I mean, even if you fall going up, you're falling up. So you're not going to have that same experience. Now, here's another thing that goes on when you're out in this. We're talking about hiking a perfect trail that's easy, right? That's a trail. Now, when we get out there, we're not hiking trails sometimes. We're bushwhacking. We're going in places. You know, we've got lava rock. You're climbing on top. You're working. Your feet are twisting and your ankles are twisting all the time. And all of a sudden, now you're not only hot, but you're tired. And then when you lose your focus, I'm telling you what, it makes this so much more difficult and actually so much more dangerous. So, you know, one of the things about this, the great news about what we do is that these sites have been around for 900 years. They're not going anywhere. So if it ain't your day, be manly or womanly enough to say, you know what, this ain't my day today. You'll always be able to go back. So don't push yourself. I mean, you know, all these things I'm telling you, I'm not following my own lessons, but I'm telling you, don't do it, because you can always come back. You know, you can always come back. Now, I will say one thing. Maria gave me, and I think it's that this new Gatorade. I saw it for like marathon runners, and it's a little squares. And I'm telling you what, that stuff worked. Another point that was made that we found out also. Now, this is not just a Gila Bend, and it's not just a Agua Fria. Anywhere you are going through the brush, and you have basically no trail, man, the weeds and the stickers attacked my socks. Like, I mean, was like wrestling with them, and the socks didn't win. And I had crap in my shoes that were poking my feet. And so I decided that I'm going to get, you know, not the what I call the Maria gators, which go like up to here, and like a wild rhino could hit you and you wouldn't feel it. I'm talking about the ones that just basically, they're about this tall, right? And they wrap around your shoe and they just cover your sock. And especially if you got low sock, because that those weeds, when you're going in Agua Fria and or not only do you ruin a pair of socks because I'm not cleaning them out, my shoes were loaded with that crap that was poking my feet. So all of a sudden now you've got heat and then you've got stress because you've got other things on your mind, like your feet. And then all of a sudden you get yourself in a precarious, and I use the precarious word, a precarious situation that, you know, all of a sudden you're not concentrating on trying to see that glyph or whatever that is. You are looking at, you know, the fact you're looking at your feet, or you've got other things that are bothering you, or your legs are bleeding, or whatever it might be. The reality is it takes you off your game when you have things like that happen. So I'd suggest to anyone, you know, and I've been looking at it, REI's got a couple different pairs that actually strap underneath your shoe. I don't know how I like that. I'll probably get a pair and see. And then they wrap around your shoe and they keep stuff out of your shoe, but they also keep those stickers that just load up. And if you've been out any of these places, you've had that where you look at your socks and you're like, I'm not cleaning this crap out. I can't, it's too much. And so make sure that you have enough sodium, you have enough salt in your body, that you're smart about what you do, because let's make sure we continue to get to hike and continue these journeys and this fun. And, you know, I'm learning. I mean, I'm learning. So it's not like, you know, it's not like I have any, you know, as a group, we have so much knowledge. And that's what I want to build when we build this. We've talked about this. This group of people that are out there, they're supporting each other. And they're supporting not only the channel, but the environment and the petroglyphs and the ruins and the sites. And they're protecting them. But we're also helping each other out, because I tell you what, I mean, I've ruined a few brand new pairs of socks. I can't do it. I had that crap. I had all the insoles out. I was grinding the inside of the shoes with my hand, turning it the stickers to powder, and then taking tape. Oh, it was unbelievable. I should have videotaped it because it looked ridiculous. But, you know, I'm also studying different shoes. I'm going some more shoes. I get the old plantar fasciitis. That is ridiculously difficult. And I feel for anybody that has it. And I happen to know about five people that have it, myself included. And I tell you what, you get up at night, and you feel like somebody smashed your feet with hammers. You know, it is ridiculous, but you know, sometimes just with me, I get out there to get today, just get loosened up to try to make sure that my feet don't freeze up. But you know, that's just part of what I got to do. It is what it is. Now, look what I got in the mail. It's mail call. I haven't even opened it. Can you read that? I don't know if you can. The only thing they got wrong, they said Mr. Okay. And I don't know where in the hell he lives, but he sure in the hell don't live here. This is from J.R. Welch from Archaeology Southwest. Now, when we talked the other day, he said he would give me all kinds of information about what they did, what they do, what they are doing. And he said he would mail this to me. And I honestly said, I'm not going to open it. I'm going to open it on the air. And I'm going to open it with everybody. And we're going to go through this together. I have no idea what's in here. It's heavy as hell. It looks like a nice deal. And so we're going to have an unboxing. And then we're going to see what's in here from Archaeology Southwest, from our good friends down there. I need to get a letter opener. Let me use the K-bar. I guess the K-bar will be sufficient. It ain't too sharp. Okay, so what do we got in here? Holy smokes. Okay, let's get this. I got a nice letter. I don't know if I can read that on the air or not. I don't know if, let's see. Here, I'm going to read it because this is from John, who's the gentleman that reached out to me. And I'm going to read this and tell you the note. Very beautiful. Nice little nice stuff right here. It's card, which is awesome. And what it says is, Jeff, the close with my compliments on your industriousness and shared interest in exploration and preservation. Let's ruminate some and then get back and continue the convo. Because we've talked now twice. There's a couple of things that I need to do to fulfill my agreement to him. And there's things that he, this was one of them. And I wanted to make sure I opened this on air. Very nice. And card. Okay. And portrait book. Of the Gila Bend. A very nice book right here. Get that down where you can see it. Okay, and a ton of newsletters. Archaeology in Southwest here. Archaeology in Tucson. The Little Colorado River National Heritage Area. Here, Hohokam ball courts. Who is and what is the Hohokam? 4,000 years of desert living. Oh my God! You know, if I read all this stuff, I might actually. Man, I tell you what, this is impressive. I mean, this is impressive. One of the things, to be honest with you, when I talked to him, one of the things important to me in this channel is as we start this preservation, is that the knowledge. I wanted more knowledge and for the channel to be able to share. My experience is that with their experience and knowledge and with us as a channel and this group of people, we could start to get more knowledge about what's going on. And here is a Archaeology Southwest magazine here. And here's another one on Archaeology Southwest. And here is another one on Antiquity. Wow, that's cool. Here. You know, and they're not brand new at doing this. They've been around for a long time. And one thing I will tell you, because they just didn't put all this stuff together, right? They have had that. And these are a lot of different magazines and stuff like that. A lot of unbelievably cool. What is preservation archaeology? By William H. Doyle. Hope I said that right. William is the he's the big boss. So the site nobody really knows. Okay. The Sonora Archaeology of the Sonora. A bookmark. Hopefully I'll need that because I've read so much. And then a bunch of pamphlets on themselves. What an impressive array of stuff. Very impressive. And so what I'll do now is I will go through that this week. And then when next week comes, we'll talk about it. Very impressive. Awesome stuff. You know, hopefully we can get some stuff going together. I'd like to go visit some of their sites, some of their over 200 sites. And so hopefully we all can get involved. And anything I have here too that anybody would like to share, if there's anything that I have or any other stuff, I'll tell you what, that's pretty impressive. I appreciate that. You know, that's the kind of stuff that you hope to have. You hope people are reaching out. You hope people are saying, hey, you know what? We love what you're doing. Hopefully you'll love what we're doing. And this group of people here that really cares about what's going on, very impressive. I'm extremely excited about digging in and seeing what I can't learn. And, you know, I'm really pleased with that. You know, what that is a good idea, Hari, is that I will reach out to, Android Power Load. Yay! That is awesome. You're awesome. I appreciate you, man. That means a lot to me. It really does. Because we are the support of you guys, just the support itself is unbelievable. And the people that are investing in Patreon, that's awesome. But Andrew Powerload, I appreciate it, man. You're awesome. That's excellent. Now, what I'm going to do next is this. I'm going to reach out to them, okay? I'm going to reach out to them, and we're going to talk. And I'm going to reach out to John, and I'm going to invite John up here. Now, they're in Tucson, but I'm going to invite him regardless before, you know, if there's some other way I can get either a Zoom or something like that. I don't know, but we're going to figure something out. But I'm going to invite him up here, and I'm going to put him – we're going to see if there's a time he can come on here. And then I'm going to start looking for other guests as well. So when you guys come in here, you have – I mean, the whole goal is that we share our knowledge, and the whole goal is that we, you know, become this group of people that, you know, I throw rocks at a lot of some of the groups that are out there, but the reality of it is nobody's got an easy job. It's not easy figuring this out. It's not. It's not an easy solution. But you know, we all agree that hiding stuff or keeping secrets is not. The way. I don't believe it's the way, but there definitely needs to have action, and we need to do things that are going to promote preservation. Again, so groups later in life, whether it be your children or your children's children, they get to come see this stuff and go experience it. You know, hopefully when you guys saw that video this week that we did, and then the other half will be Thursday, one thing you'll notice is the first thing is that we're out in this gorgeous environment. And guess what? Who you see? I mean, it's just us, man. We're out. We're you know, you're 5 million. 5 million people are in Phoenix, Arizona, and you're an hour, 40 minutes out, and there's nobody. And you are in this world that is not a hell of a lot different than when it was 800-900 years ago, except I think that the FJ they drove had rock tires, if I'm remembering correctly. I don't know if that model had. I think it did. It was more in the Flintstones design. But you're out there, and you own the world out there, and you're out there with your thoughts, and there's no one else. And how unbelievable is it? Even in a busy day up there, you know, I've seen a handful of people. That's it. In the summer, you ain't going to see anybody because we're the, you know, the lunatics that go out there. You know, one thing too, Todd's here. Todd, where the hell you been? The thing about heat out here too is that, you know, you can have it. You can have it pretty much to yourself. And that's what's cool about Arizona is that, you know, in the early mornings, you can have a lot of these places by yourself. And how spectacular was that to go out to New Boots? And, you know, that's another thing I want to talk about, too, is that I love these monuments. I love this. Hey, we're not going to tell you exactly where anything's at, but we're not going to hide anything. You want to get in your vehicle and go out there and have an adventure? Come to the monument and do that. It's one of the most awesome experiences that you can have anywhere. is to be able to go out there, you know, and be able to experience that mesa up there. How ridiculous is that? It really is another experience. So then when you read books, and this is what I've been reading, okay? When Steve Lines wanted to know how are you, oh my God, yay! We're gonna eat. It's awesome. You guys are awesome, man. You make me feel good. I appreciate you. I really do. It means the hell of a lot to me. I'm reading of Stones and Spirits, right? Man, this dude is heavy duty. When I connected those places, those mesas, it's ridiculous. And you connect all of them together, and then you start reading these things. It's unbelievable. I tell you what, it is. Darlene Scott are here. They're awesome. You start connecting everything, and you read, and then it just gets deeper and deeper and deeper. And, you know, I tell you what, though, for a guy like me, this has been a tough one. Not a lot of pictures. And, I need a couple. If you're ever – if John or any of them on there from Archaeology Southwest, yeah, give me some pictures in between. I can only go so long. Steve Lines is in the house. There he is. I knew he would get here. So, yeah, tell a little story, too. That would help me. Now, that's not maybe nobody else, but oh, my God. But this book is fascinating. When you start putting – what gets me excited is this door opening from Archaeology Southwest. It means that there'll be more information available to these guys that have really studied this stuff. And so that excites me because now I can think about the places that we've gone and we can look at it and be able to say, okay, now I understand. You know, one thing that I've been deeply involved in was this power web, okay? And it starts in this book here. And the power web in the ancient times was a belief that these buttes, these hills, these mountains, they had a web or a net of power that would be running between them. Kind of think of them being a modern day power line, right? And that this energy would flow all through, you know, all through Arizona, all through Utah, all through the states, you know, it would flow in these power points. And so you get into this stuff and you start looking at that, and then it starts changing your whole look at of what you experience when you go there. Because the first thing I do when I get on any one of these hills or buttes, the first thing I ask myself, what do I feel? You know, what do I feel? It happened to me the other day. I was like, what do I feel up here? And maybe it's me. Who in the hell knows? I'm not going to tell you that it's all like super like there, but I can tell you the last hill I went on, I was like, oh my God, this is strong, man. I feel this. And you know, if it was just me or the excitement of being there, I'm not going to tell you that, but I felt something in my own. So whatever it did to my soul, you know, it was incredible. It really was. It was really. And so they say that this power grid works between these different buttes. And so it was incredible to get on top of them to be able to experience that, you know. And so you get up on top of these mesas as well. And, man, how powerful is that stuff? How powerful is this whole thought process? You know, just to open your mind up. Now, this specific book is directly on Antelope Hill. And this whole book is Antelope Hill. And it's incredible. What's incredible to me is that the first time I experienced Antelope Hill, it was a hill. It had half of it missing. I was like, it's got some old steel like girders around it. It's got a quiosk that looks like they haven't touched it since 1947. I'm going to go 47 on that. And I'm like, what didn't, you know, and it's right next to the road. And, you know, and so I still went there. I still looked at it. I still, you know, said, this is, I mean, it's pretty cool. It was more of a stop on the way back from somewhere else. You know, it wasn't like if you was at a concert, it would be the opening act. It wouldn't be the headliner by no means. And then you start reading a book like this and you go, you have got to be kidding me. That place was ridiculous. I mean, so now I got to go back, and now I'm going to do an entire series on that Antelope Hill, entire series, because there is so much knowledge and wisdom in this book about all of it, whether it be the Euro-Americans or the ancients or the later natives or the Spanish or the Mexicans or you know, this whole cycle of the Southwest history is so fascinating. And this place is so funny because it doesn't get, you know, you don't see a lot of stuff in the diaries of the people that went through there about Antelope Hill. But after you read this, you realize that it is the crossroads. I believe that it is the crossroads of the Southwest. I really believe that. And that the interconnection of everything around it, you know, that's the heart, and that's my own personal opinion. But the more I read about there, the more I believe. And you know, they even said on that mountain or butte or hill, they really didn't think it had any spirit, but it was definitely an intricate to connect the group and the whole theory. But after reading it and then starting to really research it myself, I started to go, you know, this was a main connection to the ancient world because of the stone that was there, that was intricate, and it was so important to the culture. And then it was a pass because the river runs right next to it, the Gila. And so it was critical to the water flow, to not only the ancients, but then the stones that were on the location, but then all of the different cultures, the Spanish, all these people, the fur traders, as Maria says, which still kills me because I go out and I walk across the dry Gila and I'm thinking that, you know, that this was such a big deal was these the fur traders that were through there, the French. Oh my God, Todd! I don't even know what to say, man, other than thank you very much. You guys are awesome tonight, man. I you don't realize how much I appreciate that. It means the world to me. It means the world to me that you guys care enough about the content that we're trying to put out as well, and what we're trying to do to help what's going on as far as the preservation of this and the preservation of the cultures. You know, a lot of this stuff is getting lost. And man, I appreciate it. I appreciate it a lot. That is unbelievably awesome. Thank you very much. And I don't know what else to say, but it's awesome. But this was an intricate place where there was so much going on. And then things that I learned, you know, it is cool. What I learned was that, you know, how important some of this, you know, this, what did the Spanish bring? You know, what did they donate to these cultures, and what did they take away? And so what did they bring? You know, the watermelon, you know, the wheat, things like that. I didn't realize that. I didn't realize some of this stuff, you know, I don't know, Ethan. I mean, you could try and see what it does. Sorry, I was just kidding. You can test it. So it's so cool that I learned this stuff, man, and I never stopped learning. And you know that, you know, and to be able to share it, because man, this stuff wigs me out. I mean, I love this stuff. You know, I drove by, you know, Antelope, and I see this whole side of it missing. I'm thinking, that's crap. How in the hell could they have a quarry there? And then I read this book, and then this book tells me all this information about it, and that, you know, all the stuff that was there. unbelievable. Just a ridiculous amount of information. And then, you know, you're at these, and here's the thing too. So I read a book like this. I get to go out there. I'm there, you know, me or just a few people. And you're there kind of by yourself in your own head, in your own place. And you go back over all this history and you just look out there and you, it's just, it's so easy to imagine these wagon trains rolling by, you know, and, you know, they were talking about when they got to Antelope Hill, these wagon trains that were coming through there. Now these people had been from everywhere, right? I mean, they've been from, you know, let's just say they started in Independence. Oh my God. Steve Lines. You guys, I don't even know what to do. Oh, that's unbelievable. Holy smoke. That's ridiculous. Man, thanks. That's all I can say. I'm overwhelmed. I'm absolutely overwhelmed. Man, thank you. But you just see these wagon trains and these people that had everything that they own in this wagon. And they got to Antelope. And all of a sudden, guess what? That is 32 tacos at Jack in the Box. And I love that. That's a couple gas tanks. And I'm glad you did the math because that's more than I can do. These people had all their stuff. You know, they had all their stuff. And they got to this place after coming through all kinds of hell and high water. And there was no grain for their animals. And their animals were half dead. And so at that point, they made the decision. And what this book said was, it was like a wrecking yard for wagons and dead animals and horses and things like that. So they're there and they make this choice. And now they've hauled this crap from, let's say, Independence, Missouri. Now, I'm from there, so it's about 1,800 miles, right? So it's 1,800 miles to my house. So add another, let's go 1,900 miles, right? 1,880. So they've hauled all that crap that was so important. And they got to a point where they had to say, you know what? We're done, man. We're toast. And so they started walking. And it was like, and so they said at one time, there was all this stuff, you know, there was all this stuff just strewn out that all these people had made the decisions that they were just going to, you know, they were just going to walk from here on out. The animals were dead, you know, and I think about that stuff. I think about the ancients. I think about, you know, they talked about the Apache being, you know, unbelievably brutal, even to everybody. They were equal opportunity employers, which was awesome. I mean, they didn't give a shit who they killed. I think they didn't care who they killed. You were going to get it because their method was not to basically, they're not going to grow stuff. They're going to let you grow it. And then they're going to just take it. And the Apaches were just, man, they were badasses. I don't have any, you know, but, and then there were all these other groups there, you know, these 9, 10, and 11, a lot of them I'd never heard of either. Now, I'll give you a little bit of information about the place just because I'm so stoked about it. Now, with all these warring groups, let's take the Euro-Americans out of it and let's go pre-Euro-Americans, let's go pre-Spaniards. And so you have these warring groups and they're warring, right? They're not getting along. So they had, they say maybe it was the Pima though and one Comanche, but I'm not sure about that, Maria, that they're not completely, how come you're siding with the Apaches, Ernest? That's kind of funny. So they're warring back then, right? So this thought process that the world was beautiful and then it got south was crap. They were warring way before that, you know, because they were always groups that just didn't get along, man. People are people. No groups ever got along, right? And so they had these groups that were warring, and the Apaches were brutal. They were one of the bad boys, I guess you could say. Now, I was told the Comanches were badder, but the Apaches were a hell of a lot. They caused a lot of grief to a lot of people, regardless of who it was. They were the good guys. But and they were the good guys, because, you know, if Ernest says that, I'm going to go with that. They would have. So the Apaches would have joined the Sugar Hill Gang. And so the Apaches. So the cool thing was, is that you just study this. And so they have this conflict going on all the time. So, and then another group comes in. So then you bring in the Spanish, right? And then they cause conflicts, and they bring their ways of life. Sometimes it's welcome, sometimes it's not, you know. But, and you know, this isn't about, I don't give a damn who is right or wrong. That's not what I'm just looking at how the interaction and the history changed as these groups came in, you know, and looking about how they came in. And, you know, thinking about, you know, what I think about is the fact that on the Gila River, you could take a flat boat and you could take it all the way down to Colorado, and then you could float that all the way down to the Sea of Cortez, which is incredible that you could have done that. And they knew about the sea, you know, they knew about this stuff. So you start going through the different generations of 8,000 years ago, and you think about 8,000, and then you think about all these cultures that changed and evolved and went into the different groups and things that changed them, you know, whether that be warring or whatever that might be, oppression, you know, whatever you want to call whatever the different scenario has happened at every time, you realize that I mean, I just look at the history of and just am fascinated by this whole thought of all these cultures. And eventually what happens is they collide, right? They collide. Why? Because they're fighting each other for, you know, the necessities, right? There's only so much for everyone. And so all of a sudden they start colliding because one group wants to do this or one group wants to do that. And so it's incredible just to see a place like Antelope Hill and be able to go, okay, I can sit down at that bank on that river. I can look at this bridge, which was the first bridge in 1915 that crossed the Gila Bend automobile-wise. It got blown out and closed down in the 40s because that used to be a rapid, raging river when it would rain. And so, you know, and it would blow out all the crops. So now the reason that Antelope Hill, one of the reasons is because of the grinding stone, the quality was one of the best anywhere in the United States from what this book said, right? The quality of the stone to grind with is another area too that I'm not familiar as far as the geology, but the stones were unreal for grinding. So everybody used that area, and it was kind of like a kill-free zone. So everybody was welcome to go there in peace to actually mine this stone. And it's incredible. And it's just incredible that this one place that really didn't get that I call the intersection. You know, if you'd asked me that, like 2 months ago, you'd have said, hey, where do you think the intersection of the entire Southwest, where do you really think that is? And I would have told you it would have been the Painted Rock. I would have said that. I would have said that that's the intersection. But one thing it doesn't have, though, is it doesn't have the water. And that's, the water was in a different place. Now, it might have been closer as it run against that one wall over there. But there's something about the fact that everybody was drawn to this Antelope Hill, everyone. And so much stuff happened there that, but it didn't, you know, the funny thing was it didn't weigh heavy on these people that made, you know, a lot back in then they did a lot of diary work. especially the Euro-Americans. And they did a lot of diary stuff. So they wrote about where they went. And not a lot of people wrote about this place, but it was so interesting. You know, and so there are sites all the way from there all the way down to the Colorado. Now, the Colorado had stuff all the way up. And then if you, you know, if you get the big map out and you start tracking the waterways and you start looking about all this stuff and how the Gila runs all the way up, you know, and you look at, you know, even the Verde and you look at all that and you look at these waterways, man, it's so fascinating that everybody is walking down these lines, man. They're following the water. And, you know, that's what they were talking about. The water, you know, it was critical that the trails somewhat got close to the water because they needed it for their animals. I'm just fascinated to go back there and go, okay, this is where the stagecoach stop was here in this vicinity here. Here is the area where they would, what they call the graveyard, basically. Then you have the area over here where there is the, where they used to call it the fishing island. And I was there and I didn't even know it, but there's a guy's house sitting on it. So there's a guy's house sitting on an area that used to be a place where they used to fish off of, and there's supposed to be petroglyphs over there. I had no idea. No idea that there's this house sitting on that location. And, you know, no idea that, you know, when you walk across that dry Gila, man, they were running boat flatboats down that thing. And so, you know, how incredible was that? I mean, it just... this stuff just fascinates me as I go. And what I'm hoping is with that information that that John sent is that we, you know, this olive branch and this information that is opened up just gives us some more information to make our journeys and our travels more important. You know, we don't always get all that information when you go somewhere and then you get it and you're like, oh, my God, I got to go back, right? I have to go back. Oh my God. I don't know. Paul, you got, man, that's so awesome. I don't even know what to say. That is much respect to all you guys. You know, I just hope that you appreciate what we do. I know you do, or you wouldn't have done that, but I just want to let you know that is so appreciated. It's unbelievable. Thank you. Now where the hell was I? Now I don't even know. Not a lot of people. Yeah, hell yes. I'll subscribe to you, Hari. Thank you, Paul. You're awesome. I appreciate that, man. That is legit. Hell, it's all legit. You know, it's all legit. It's legit that you guys get on here and watch, man. That's legit. And, you know, you get on here and that, you know, we have it's so cool for me to look on here and see the interactions that you guys have between you. And all of a sudden these people and this family starts to grow. And all of a sudden, you know, you get everybody interacting, you know, and, you know, it's just like, hey, if everybody wants to put a channel up, I mean, my God, I'll help anybody, right? I mean, you know, it's all, you know, there's room for everybody. One thing I will say that's cool about YouTube is that there's no, you don't have competition because, you know, you don't have a time frame, right? Hell yes, I appreciate that. Thank you. You don't have a time frame, right? It's not like you're fighting for the 8 o'clock slot or the 7 o'clock slot. You can watch this at any time. And if you can't see it, you know, if you can't be here tonight because of whatever reason, you can watch it tomorrow, you know, if you want to. I think it's going to be 100 bitty for the hat, Steve. What are you talking about? God, you guys are blowing me away. When you can get me to stop talking, you have done something, trust me. You know, so you don't have a time slot, so you're not fighting over a time slot. So that's what's so cool about this. There's room for everybody. I mean, anybody would want to do this, I would tell them, be prepared for a challenge and be prepared for a hell of a lot of work and be prepared for nightmares and editing and all that cool stuff. But you know what, when you get stuff like this, just the response, it's you can't beat that either. That because that's what makes us so awesome. It's just the fact that, you know, so, you know, I help as much as I can. You know, I'm always going to be learning. I'm never going to know. You know, one thing I loved about the fact that when, you know, somebody says that there's a practice, you know, a doctor has a practice or a lawyer has a practice, and that's because they never, ever really learn it. And I think most places, things are like that, right? It's all about, you know, practicing. I'm practicing to learn this stuff. And I've been doing this for so long as far as just, it's taking me forever to figure out the editing. It's taking me forever to figure out all this stuff. And I'll help anybody with that. I mean, it can be a handful, but you know what? The reality of it is I love to do it and I get to do this, and that's pretty, pretty cool. In the book, why Antelope Hill was damaged in one site. Okay. If you haven't been to Antelope Hill, it's like, well, what the Native Americans say now it looks like is somebody tried to eat it. And that's what's in there. It seriously says that in the book. And it also said that they didn't take some of the elk. Holy Christ. Ethan, I appreciate you, man. For the hat. Okay, so I'll get it for the hat. I'll get it for the hat, bud. I think the hat's 200. Oh, Jesus, God. So I don't even know what to say. I don't even know what to say. And again, I don't even know what to say. So the more information we all have, man, I want everybody to go to the places I've been. I really do. If you can, I'll go. Oh, the Jesus Christ. Okay. Okay. Okay, Don. Oh, Jesus, Carmony. You need to do it. Okay. Holy smokes. Oh, Jesus, guys. I did have a nice fresh haircut. Thanks, Don. That was the dance. It would suck, but did you like the sound of music when it kind of went over, like at the end? Did you like the sound of music? John was looking at me like, because that was the end of the hike. He's like, you've lost your mind. You've lost your mind. Okay. He didn't know what I was doing, but I had this weird thought of that's what I wanted to do for some reason, because I felt like I was up there in the sound of music, because you had these tall weeds, and it was like really, actually, it was really cool. But it was really fun. Back to Antelope. Half of Antelope is missing, right? It's been quarried. And you're like, how in the hell could they quarry this place? I'm kind of rock man, kind of. I kind of am. I feel like that. Rock man is one of my favorite things. Rock man is so incredible. It's one of my favorite things ever, rock man. So they quarried it, right? And so a lot of times people think, I appreciate that, Harry. I appreciate everybody. You guys are awesome. I don't even know what to tell you. But they quarried that hill, and it looks kind of terrible. But, you know, part of the reason that they have this book was because they had to do some research before they did that. So what they did was they had to do something about the Gila because the river was going, oh, Jesus, criminy. Okay, that's all. Jesus Christ. I love sombreros. I really do. I do love sombreros. I love the whole Mexico thing. I love Mexico. I'm never going to get to this. So they had the Gila. Darlin Scott, thank you. I appreciate that immensely. I'm at a loss for words. I don't know what to say, but I appreciate it sincerely. I really do. So they quarried it because they needed rock for the Gila, so because the Gila was blowing out and going everywhere. So the F-bomb logo. I know who else needs the F-bomb logo now, if you heard the video. So they quarried that for that reason. But they also quarried that to put that Santa Fe Bridge in right there. Wilson James, what's up? So they used it for that bridge too, to be able to build that bridge that went across to Gila as well, for the train tracks. But they also had to do a study before they let them do that. And, you know, I tell you one thing I learned in this whole deal too, was that a lot of times, you know, we think that, you know, they had this land with these special things on them. And what they talked about was that a lot of times groups don't want the land. They don't want the responsibility of the land, because if somebody would be on them and get hurt. And so they don't want the responsibility of the land. And so you would think anybody would take the land, any group would take the land, like, yeah, just take it, right? It's land, right? But they don't. I feel like Steve McQueen tonight, just not that cool, because there's nobody that cool. But they don't. So they did a study because they knew they were going to take this rock regardless. And they got all these groups and all these nations to come in, everyone as far as the natives, and to talk about what the hill meant and what it was, and all the information they could gather. And so before they did that, they built this book, and that's probably why they've got this book, is because they had to do a complete study on all the petroglyphs and what they meant, and the whole nine yards. You know, it was all kinds of cool stuff like that, where, so it was neat they had that book, because they did studies of all that, you know. And I wish there, and I'm hoping that there's a lot more books on a lot more of this stuff. But the experience that, you know, I might need to get that, because, you know, funny thing about that cliff, okay, is I was never afraid, because it happened so fast. Seriously, it was like ice, bam. And by the time I even thought about it, yeah, so the chauffeur does have a hat. I stopped before I even had a chance to even be afraid. And so it didn't scare me, because it happened too fast. It happened so fast that I didn't have a chance to be afraid. It just hit like that. And then I've stopped. And by the time I really realized what happened, I hooked those rocks on the bottom, and I stopped. And so the cool thing was, it never scared me, because I never processed it. It was too fast. But I had talked about that grass. You know, later you'll see more of the cliff climbing on the other side. And one of the things you're going to hear me saying is that grass is what scares you. Because when you're on an incline and you've got that dead grass, that stuff is like lightning, man. You know, it will take you down in a heartbeat. And so that's what, you know, that's why you'll see in this next video, you'll see when we're out there hanging out on the petroglyphs in that area. It's, man, that place is cool. That place is cool. But man, I know that there was an animal down there. You could see the trail worn out, and you knew it wasn't a human, because it was a big cat. It had to have been, because the way that trail, that hill was worn out. And, you know, I've got, you know, at the ranch, I've got every animal. I've got all kinds of animals at the ranch. I've got everything. And that trail was so predominant. You know, it looked like a human trail, and I knew it wasn't, because a human couldn't have climbed that. And my only thought was there something down in that cave, you know? And man, I was like, I wanted down there so bad, because you, you could see on that cliff, you could see petroglyphs down below even. So they were climbing that wall and probably were born on it. So it wasn't a big deal to them. But I did, I had this feeling something was down there and I wanted to get down there. And man, I almost got down there. I almost did. I didn't plan that. But man, it was, but right there when I hit, boom, man, that big old, what I call a palm-sized piece of shard. Oh, I love those. Man, I love those because, you know, you're not that far now from some type of, you know, a pot when you get something as big as your hand. And there was stuff there like that. You know, yeah, I mean, you know, it could have been more accessible. You know, and again, these guys were born on that hill. You know, they were born on that hill. And they you know, that wasn't going to be a big deal. But also to think that they didn't fall and to think they didn't fall off stuff, that wasn't true either. You know, they just because you was born there didn't mean that you didn't have a lapse. You'll see dead man on rocks, petroglyphs, and man, I'm telling you what. But, you know, you think about them guys going up and down that hill every day because they would have been. They'd been running down the water. And that was that mesa up there is ridiculous. If you get a chance to go, you don't even have to go that far deep. Now, here's the funny thing. We were two hours and I think 15 or 2 hours and 30 minutes from the entry. It took us 2 hours and 30 minutes to get there once we got into Agua Fria. That's how far out we were. And we weren't at the edge. So when you get out that far, you're going to see some stuff, whether it be wildlife, things like that, that you're not going to get. There hadn't been anybody in that location for a hell of a lot of years. For a hell of a long time. I mean, it's not your normally, you know, high place that people go see. It's not. But I'm telling you what, it was ridiculous. It was really, and we'd been wanting to go there for so long. But the thing about Agua Fria is you kind of need to go like when we did, because man, if it rains, that place stays muddy for 30 days or 40 days. And if you get in Agua Fria and it's raining, you might not get out. And I don't care how bad a four-wheel drive you've got. That you wouldn't be the first guy or gal that got stuck back there. So that's the only thing about some of these locations is that even in the, you know, in the heat, you know, it's better to go in the heat than go when you think you possibly could get into rain. But stepping back into to Antelope Hill, they actually mined that side of the hill. So they took a big chunk out of it. So it's really not too pretty right now. It doesn't look too pretty. So you kind of almost say, well, there couldn't have been anything cool on it if they let them tear it down or tear it up. But that's not the way it was. You know, they let them do it. And so ancients have been mining those rocks for metates forever. And that's the place they would all come to. That was where the best grinding stone of all the hills were at. So they all migrated to there. And that's one of the reasons I think it's got such a special meaning. And you know, all, you know, because it was a crossroads again, everything was right there as well, as far as the water. So all the different groups of all the different cultures eventually rolled through that area. And how fascinating is that? I tell you what, man, and there's some characters that live back there. Holy smoke. I'm telling you, man, the you think about, you know, when people say, well, man, it's, look how bad it's gotten. It didn't used to be bad. You know, it was so much worse. I mean, you would have to have a mentality. I mean, I'm imagining it, right? Because I didn't live there and I didn't talk to any of these guys. But you would think if you were 40, man, you were ancient. You were old. I would think if you were 40, the average, I'm not talking about the one guy that seemed to live forever. I'm talking about the average group of all the people, you know, all the natives, all the Spaniards, all, you know, the Euro-Americans, all these groups of people that if you lasted, man, you were either lucky or you were a bad hombre. Because I'm telling you what, how difficult their life would have been every day getting up and just going through the process. And you would have to have been in unbelievable shape. Unbelievable. Perfect. Android Power Load. Send to put them on there. I'd love to see. Utah is a place that I would love to go because they have I love the spaceman type petroglyphs or pictographs, I should say. I love those. I love that weird that they did that was totally different than what I'm seeing here, and I'm going to get down there. But, you know, this book here opened another door on another three places, okay? You start reading in here, and it says, yeah, and there's a hill where they used to burn all the bodies, where they used to do all the, when they died, they would take them there and burn the bodies. And so how interesting is that? There was a hill where they used to do that. And, you know, you read it and you're like, my gosh, all this stuff is in here, you know. And then this one hill they talked about is they definitely have spirits there. So we got to go find out, right? We got to go find out if we got spirits. That's important. We need to go to those places and get on top of those hills and buttes and see what's out there. Because, you know, you do experience that the whole areas when you get up like on Powers or one of those places or just when you look at the Agua Fria and you're on the edge of that thing, I'm telling you, you're just in awe. I mean, you know, you think, well, we got the Grand Canyon. That whole area is filled with all that stuff. And, you know, we weren't, as crazy as it sounds, we weren't that far from Black Mesa. I mean, we were a long way across, unless you were Evel Knievel and you were jumping the Grand Canyon. You weren't far distance-wise. You were far trying to get over there, but you weren't far distance-wise. So all that stuff is built up. Now, one thing I'll tell you that was extremely sad that I have to go see is the Facebook ruins area. That whole area is burnt. So I don't know, you know, I don't know what's, you know, I mean, I'm going to have to go back down there and see. That was very sad that happened. I would, you know, I love that place. That place is, and you know, that there's one rock that is the most incredible rock that I've seen, you know, that's been worked. And I really believe now after going to other places, you realize that was probably a bell rock and it made more sense. So as you go to different locations, you just gather this information and you keep going it just fascinates me. It really does. And again, just for Archaeology Southwest to open the door like that, what a cool deal. It was extremely cool deal. Kudos to them. And hopefully now, you know, I can do the things that I need to do and see if I can't help them. And we can have a relationship that's going to benefit everybody on this list. I mean, that's what's important is that, you know, we're all together. And we get the information and I can't wait. I can't wait to get the door open and it's incredible. And so, you know, has anybody got any questions about anything that's going on? I am going out of town. I'm going back to Independence and we're going to visit my wife's family. And we're going to go back for a week. And so what I'm going to try to do, and I don't know how well this is going to work, I'm going to try to go live on my phone from there in locations that, you know, I know the town really well, and I'm going to try to take you on some areas that because that town is so historical. I mean, it is unbelievably historical because it was really, you know, they call St. Louis the gateway to the East, but it really isn't. It's Kansas City, because if you look at the map and you see the Mississippi runs north and south, and then the Missouri runs east to west. So they would take the riverboat from St. Louis and they would take the riverboat to Kansas City. And so then they would get off there, either there or St. Joe, which is on up north. It's about an hour from Kansas City up north. So they would either leave from St. Joe or they'd leave from basically Kansas City, AKA Independence. They're the same. They're together kind of. And so they would leave for the wagon trains on all the trails. And so I'm going to try to get and do a live on a phone and be on location to some of these places and see if I can't connect some of the dots for you and try to put them together in a small location and even walk it and maybe make something that would be kind of, it really is interesting to think that, that these people started there and they ended up, you know, let's just say to Antelope Hill, you know, you're talking 1900 miles and they started there and they still wasn't where they wanted to be. They still wasn't in California. You know, if that's what their destination ended up being. But even if they came to Albuquerque or they came to Phoenix, which really probably was not feasible, they probably weren't coming here. That they took that route and the hardships that they would have dealt with on that trail would have been unbelievable. You know, it really would have been. And so the story of the all this as you go on is really incredible. And there's so much history there. There really is, whether it be, you know, the James, you know, last time I was there, nobody really seemed to watch the videos that I did. Do you know, you must know my Steamboat Arabia story, Steve. Have you ever heard my Steamboat Arabia story? Maybe you have. That's why you put Steamboat Arabia there. That's a fascinating story. And I've told it before on here, so I'm sure that's where he's picking that up. A quick cliff notes for those that didn't know. A friend of mine from high school that I went to high school with dug the Steamboat Arabia up out of a cornfield about 30 years ago. And what their goal was, because they were treasure hunters, their goal was that if they could get, oh my God. Awesome. Thank you, Ethan. I appreciate you, man. We'll go through the trails and do a little, hopefully, Quantrill action, a little bit of all kinds of different stuff. Some Wild West, some haunted houses. There's a house there that the guy that owned the Star Lines, which was the guy that basically put together the routes to take you west if you were going to go west, made his fortune, and his house is ridiculous. I did a lot of that stuff. If you see it on there, you know, the Steamboat Arabia is fascinating. And you know, it's incredible, but there's so much more. I mean, the real start of the Civil War was in basically the Kansas City area. And it happened way before the Civil War started. You had the South and you had the North battling guerrilla style for years before that even started. So all that stuff started before the fire got put on these actual Civil War itself. It really took place in Kansas and Missouri. And it's an incredible story. Bleeding Kansas. That's no, I mean, it's an incredible story. And then those people pushed west, you know, a lot of those people did. So this whole migration of these Euro-Americans that are coming across here and then the collision because, you know, the natives, you know, and them going, my God, these guys ever going to stop, you know, and they didn't. And that battle, you know, and I mean, how crazy was that? That was, you know, an incredible story. Pretty sad on top of it, you know, but it is what it is as far as the history. And you know, man, it was incredible. But the hardships coming across there were unreal. And the lawlessness that was coming and the people that, you know, the guy they talked about, we talked about in the book, and we'll talk about him when I do the Antelope Hill deal. He, Going West movie. You know, one, I love how the West was won. I loved how the West was won. I really do. Ernest Hubble. I like, there's a place called the Smokehouse, Liberty Smokehouse, and it's been there a long time. Now, I like, you know, I like Gates and Sons. I there's so many of them that are like the standards, but there was a newer group about 30 years, say newer, that came out. And it was incredible. The barbecue there is absolutely You know, not anymore, Steve. You're more than welcome. That's not even an issue anymore. but the barbecue in Kansas City is the best anywhere. I still say that. There's not. I don't miss a lot of stuff from back home. I love where I live. I think it's great. This fit me. It fit my style. It fit my personality. It kind of the Southwest allowed me to become who I wanted to be. You know, which is awesome. I mean, it's a gift to get to do this. But Kansas City was cool. I mean, it was cool. There's a time where I'm glad I left and I'm glad I went this direction. The weather's absolutely horrendous. I hate the weather. I absolutely hate the weather. Give me 106 a day. I take it all day long. But there are so many historical things that happen, you know, whether it be, you know, in Leavenworth or that era or the era coming out, or, I mean, there's just so many incredible facts if you like, you know, the old West type stuff. And I love all of it. I mean, I love the whole story. I love the story of the West and the whole like deal. And you know, I love the pre though. I love going into the ancients. I love going into that. You know, there's a lot of sad stuff. You know, a lot of terrible atrocities. And that's just how we, you know, and everybody treat, you know, one thing about it is everybody treated everybody terrible. There, from what I can figure out. Double tap from Ethan is exactly right. Ethan did the deal. Double tap. It even looks weird. I look like that. Looks like the monkey on what was the Clint Eastwood movies when the monkey went like that? What was that? What was that? Rule three. But the history is so cool, and you know. Like Quantrell, here's a guy that he's a school teacher and he really doesn't have a side. He's not on the East and he's not on the North and he's not on the South. He isn't. He's a school teacher from Ohio. I believe it's Ohio. And he goes to Kansas and he's a school teacher and he decides that he sees these guys getting rich because, see, the truth of the matter is this. The Confederates at that time before the war and the Union really weren't Confederates and they really weren't Union. They were thugs that just dressed up in either a Union uniform or a Confederate uniform. And they really didn't have any affiliations, either one of them, with either group. They just figured out this was a good way, you know, for us to be able to get together and then we can go rape and pillage and steal and burn and have fun. I guess that's what they wanted to do. That's all it really was. But the problem was when they did that, they would take a guy like the Cole Youngers who were basically for the North, but because the Union came in and killed his dad, or the Confederates, and it really wasn't the real Confederates, he turned against them and become Confederate, you know? So the vice versa. I mean, so they switched sides thinking that group was the one that was responsible. And the truth of the matter was they were just thugs. And so that happens so many times in history where one group, you know, a guy's motivation, whether it be Geronimo, he had the same motivation because of what happened to him. Now, it was a little different. It was who he thought it was. But he carried that motivation all his life and went from being the shaman, basically, to not the shaman, to being the warrior. And so, but all these guys, these groups of people, something twisted them and spun them. And they were off and running. Well, I'm glad you've been shadow watching me, and I'm glad you came out of the shadows, Ethan. Was a tenderfoot Jayhawks, like you said. Was he a tenderfoot Jayhawks, like you said? You know, Quantrell, I don't look at Quantrell as being, you know, again, he was a school teacher. He just wanted the excitement of, he saw these guys getting rich, and he figured they were getting notoriety and fame and famous, and he wasn't going to get that as a school teacher. And so he became this character. You know, he wasn't like Jesse James. Jesse James was brutal. You know, Frank James wasn't sweet either. Cole Younger, or all those guys were pretty, pretty desperate guys. But Quantrill really wasn't. I mean, he didn't. He became that kind of, but he was never the guy. I mean, you know, if you read the accounts of him, he was never, you know, he wasn't that badass. He had guys that would do his dirty work for him. But it's really unbelievable that he, you know, that here's this guy that etched his name in history, and he just wanted to become somebody. So all these guys were doing all this border wars with Missouri, Kansas, were doing all this border war stuff way before the Civil War. You know, so they had all this stuff going on. Then when the Civil War started, it really, you know, escalated. And all the places, you know, that we lived and we go, whether it be Lee's Summit or Kearney. Kearney is where all the James Brothers farms at. That is still there. That's a cool place you get to go. Again, there's so many places if you get to travel across the Midwest, it's fun to go do. Quantum Parker, that was an that's so interesting. That is a great story, Clay. I haven't seen you on here before, but I appreciate it. Welcome, man. The Quantum Parker story is unbelievable. I mean, it really is. I mean, and you know, a lot of these guys that ended up being the badass cowboys, they were people from back east that just, they wanted to be cowboys, you know, they wanted to be a cowboy, you know, all I want to know is the truth of what happened, really. I don't want to side with anybody, you know. I mean, I read some, you know, you read all this stuff about, I have not ever read The Empire of the Summer Moon. I've not, Clay, but it sounds like something I'm going to need to do. But, you know, you read about these guys that came west, and, you know, they were, a lot of these guys were normal guys, you know. There's a great book out there too on, if you're into the cowboy western stuff, about the ranch in Oklahoma, and I can't think of the name of the 501 ranch or something like that, had numbers where all of the cowboys that were in the western movies, every one of them almost came out of that ranch, because they used to do, you know, the Wild West shows back in the day with Wild Bill and all those guys. And so when Hollywood needed these guys for these movies, they all came from that ranch. And it's a fascinating story. It really is, that these guys, and they were, a lot of those guys were, you know, they were the real deal anyway. You know, they just figured out a different way to make a living, which is pretty incredible. You know, I've done videos on other guys out there, other cowboy, you know, Western stars and things like that. And I love all of them. You know, everything I read about the Comanches, you know, that's a badass group of guys there. I'm telling you what, Ernest, have you read that? If it's got the Comanches in it, I know you read it. There ain't no doubt in my mind. I'm just intrigued by it. I just am. I don't know how else to say it, but I'm absolutely intrigued by just the whole, just history, you know, and how the things that are here today and why they're here. And, you know, it might be the canal system. So, you know, these guys come in and they're looking at this and they realize that they've got canal systems in Phoenix, that, you know, these people before them are way smarter than they were. They already had all this stuff dialed in. And you know what? How cool is that? I mean, you know, that they already had this stuff figured out. You know, Phoenix is a weird place to me, only because it kind of didn't, you know, if it wouldn't been for air conditioning, Phoenix would have always been this sleepy little town. It wasn't, you know, but the cultures around here, even though I'm told the weather was probably not as hot and there was probably more vegetation at the time, litter of the Southwest. So I'm told that the weather back in the ancient, more ancient times, you know, back to the 1200s, the 1450s, you know, it's just like at Agua Fria. You know, Agua Fria shows the first group of nomads basically come in there at 700. And then the next group came in, you know, between 1100. And then they came in, then they started putting permanent structures basically to 1450. And then in the 1450 window, you know, the water ran out. But, you know, it's kind of interesting, you know, this culture where you find these places where the ruins are still there and they had some type of system to farm, then the culture and expanded and the population expanded because they could feed them. You know, you didn't think about that either. You know, some of these groups had to stay small because you had to be able to feed everybody, right? And some of these places like Casa Grande, who had 3,000 people, and some of the ones in Tempe that had even more than that, you know, they had to get to a point that's the alarm. Man, I don't feel like leaving because, holy smokes, you guys took care of me. I'll go overtime tonight only for that. If you guys want me to stay and you want to keep going, I'll go a little longer. I had a deal where I was going to go 90 minutes, but my gosh. I mean, the generosity tonight and is unbelievable. With all the forest fires lately, what are your thoughts of the impact fires have on petroglyphs and other artifacts? That is a great question. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to go up and try to go firsthand to the what I call it the Facebook ruins. That's not the real name of it. It got impacted. It got burnt. From what I could see, unless they saved it, because I couldn't exactly see it when I was coming by, but I am going to go up there and take a look and see what the impact was in some of those areas. I will say one thing, and kudos to the guys and gals that do that, because that is it. That would be a hell of a job. They know where a lot of these places are. Again, a great reason that they're not secret to at least some people. So when this stuff like this happens, you know, I know last year they worked extremely hard on saving Roger's Trawl when that burnt up. It looks like Facebook ruins got it, though. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go up there and take a look and see what impact it really does. That would probably be a good show because, you know, it is just rocks and stuff. But I can tell you that. That varnish is impacted by certain things, the varnish that's on the rocks. I can tell you that it is. And so is there a possibility that some of the petroglyphs could be absolutely, there could be some damage? Absolutely. And that's why I want to get up there and see. You know, one of the terrible things about here is the fires is that, it's not just the initial fire. It's like Fish Creek Hill, that even though they put the fire out, they had the road open back up, and then the first rain blew the road completely out. And it just, you know, without any vegetation, the hills don't hold. So then you run into facts if there are some type of walls and things like that. Then you're really running into trouble. But I will say one thing. They knew where Roger's Trawl was in some of those areas, and they saved him. They actually got in there and saved him. Steve Lines, 30 more. I will do 30 more minutes. I will go till 9 o'clock because I appreciate you guys. You guys are awesome. I tell you, I've never, you know, I mean, it's ridiculous. I don't even know what to say. But so it's nice to know where those places are at. I don't know, but I know that the impact on any of the land, because there's nothing stopping the water from running and just, you know, just tearing the whole land, the area up. And then you get all these mudslides and stuff like that. It destroyed Fish Creek, which is one of my favorite places. I love that hill. I love that place. We did the ghost thing kind of down there, or the superstitions at night. And that's a creepy ass place at night too. I'll throw that out there just for fun. But what a cool place. But that place is beat up so bad because there's no vegetation, you know, and there's nothing holding that soil. And I can see that being really a problem with any type of structures, walls, things like that. That's where I see the issue or the problem. And, you know, a lot of the highway up on 17 going to Agua Fria on the east side is burnt, and it burnt hard. And like I said, I know there's three sets of ruins down there on that area, in that vicinity, not directly there, but in that vicinity. And I did need to go up there and go take a look at that and do a video on it, because that's another reason that a lot of this stuff can't be secret, because it's never going to stop. You know, we're not ever going to stop having forest fires in Arizona. It's not going to happen. And, you know, we can get better at eliminating a lot of the reasons why we have them, because of a problem with people driving through high grass with hot vehicles. That's caused us problems in the past, or people throwing cigarettes out the window. You know, a car fire started one of them. There ain't a hell of a lot they could have done about that. But then there's also the natural disasters that the ancients dealt with, you know. And the cool thing, is they dealt with it too, and they could tell that too when they dig some of the trenches. Another thing in here was fascinating was they dug trenches to look at the levels of soil and how it had changed. So, you know, they could get into that science. It's way, way above my head and above my pay grade, but it was cool in here to look at that. This book is so in depth, you know. Hari, he could read this like a novel, and he'd be thinking he'd be reading a novel, because he's got that brain like that. He's got that technical brain. And mine is more of, it needs to almost be maybe a story of some type that makes it a little more interesting. And then I'll take that and make it a story. That's one of the reasons I want to do that. There's a lot of stuff going on that, you know, who knows. That's why we have to know where they're at. I mean, people need to know where they're at. Now, I'll say when I went through, if you saw the Black Mesa, look at the stuff that I went there. Kudos to those guys. Man, I'm telling you what, here they are. Man, they got the gear on, and they're in the same stuff I'm in. And I've stripped down today. I've stripped down. So, and it was not comfortable. It wasn't terrible today, but it wasn't comfortable. But how crazy was that? How crazy that those guys got to go do that in the heat of the battle in this. And then you get out there and you think it's hot, get in the middle of a fire. My gosh. I want to go up. I haven't been to that memorial up there either. And I need to get up there. I do, because that was a pretty cool deal that they did for that. Because it was a terrible tragedy that could happen. But that's part of, when those guys do that, man, they know what's there. And I'm telling you what, it's a scary-ass job, but I appreciate the fact that they do that. Now, that's being of real service, because I'm telling you what, that is in the middle of it. And the fact that, you know, and again, even if the fire didn't attack the hills, for example, the erosion, you know, if the erosion got, you know, if the rain came, it would take the walls down easy. I could see that happening. That was a terrible tragedy. And I appreciate, you know, it meant a lot to me that those guys, they didn't let that fire get to Black Mesa. You know, they knew it was up there. They protected it. I don't know if they could have got, and who knows how fast it hit the Facebook ruins, but, that's a special place. That is a special place. And those walls aren't, you know, I believe those are sheep herders. But still, there's ancient stuff there as well. And that's what I love about this repurposing, right, in a sense. There's a good location. It was a good location for a reason, because these guys used it. And then they used it forever. And then the next group comes in and says, wow, you know, this is the perfect place for us to do the same thing that we're going to do. And I love that. I love when the different groups go to the same places, you know, and I saw a lot of that in Agua Fria as well. A lot of sheep herders came through that area, you know, on down to Sheep Bridge. And, that's another great place you get a chance to go. You know, that's not really ancient related, other than there's kind of a hot spring down there. And if there's a hot spring anywhere, there were ancients at it at one time. There's no doubt in my mind, because that was a holy place. If you had ancient, you had hot springs. Another place that's cool, that's kind of opened back up, even though it's kind of a little off, is Castle Hot Springs up by Lake Pleasant. Now, the interesting thing about Castle Hot Springs that makes it interesting is the history. Again, it's the location. The ancients used to go there because Castle Hot Springs is a hot springs. And then as the generations and the people came in, then all of a sudden, you know, it evolved into Castle Hot Springs, which was basically kind of like a dude ranch. It was originally built by the railroad executives as a place for them to go and hang out in the middle of nowhere and have fun and do what they wanted to do and go wild. And then it kind of became a dude ranch. And it is the location that John F. Kennedy was taken to when he got burned up in the PT boat, when he got that problem. When he got shipped back here, his dad sent him to Castle Hot Springs and to recuperate from that. And there's a lot of funny stories about his escapades there, as well as other escapades that he had. And Castle Hot Springs opened back up after being in disrepair, and there was a fire, lost a couple of the buildings, but they've rebuilt some of it. And it's still a historic place. The Vanderbilts, all the rich, super rich East Coast people, all of them came here. And they wanted to live and they wanted to know what it was like in the Wild West. And so Castle Hot Springs is a great day trip with the family outside of Phoenix if you want to go, because you got Kennedy there, you've got ancients there, you've got Vanderbilts, you got all the East Coast money that used to come there. And you know, they'd have their own little bunk houses and stuff like that and feel like they were living in the Wild West. He wasn't there with Marilyn Monroe, but he was there. He did have a special nurse. He did have a special nurse, they said. But that's a fascinating place. It really is. And you come in, you're driving down a gravel road, and all of a sudden you see this oasis in the middle of nowhere, and you can't believe where you're at. And it's a fascinating place. It really is. It's a great, one of those great stops that has everything. You know, it's got ancient culture. It's got more modern culture. And guess what the phone number is? 1. First phone in Arizona. Was at Castle Hot Springs. First phone. So their phone number was 1. That's pretty interesting. I thought that was really neat. But I love that kind of, I love that stuff. You know, that, you know, it doesn't have to be super ancient to me at one time. But I like how, you know, places become different, whether it be, for example, in here it talks about Agua Caliente, you know, the hot springs that are in by Gila. And there were hot springs there as well. And then it became, you know, originally that's where they think the Oatman girls were taken there to Castle Hot Springs after the massacre. Whether that's true or not, I don't know, but that's what I was told. There's a great article on that. I'm going to do a whole Oatman deal as well. I'm going to track them from the time that they were abducted and then followed all the way. I've got a guy that wrote a book about it that's going to help me track that back in all those locations of where they went and how they went. I mean, I love the, you know, the fact that there's hot springs. So automatically, you know, you have a place that was safe. Can you imagine, you know, living way back then and having like a hot bath? I mean, how incredible that would have been. That would have been unbelievable. Barrier Canyon in style in Utah. Tell me more, Hari. Tell me more. So that's what's so incredible to me, is to get the different cultures that come in. And I use the word repurpose. They come in and, you know, the ancients knew. This guy's knew. They knew why it was important, why it was good. I mean, they knew that. And it was incredible because I just love that, because now you got all this history that just layers around it and goes up, you know. And you know, one of the things that I hope doesn't happen is that, you know, is one thing I was talking about in this book, and it talked about the fact that some of the native cultures are losing their some of their history and their past, because they're losing, you know, people that know how to speak the native tongue, or the native tongue also has been integrated with different ways and tones. And we talked about that before, but I hope it doesn't happen. You know, I hope it does. I hope something changes so we don't lose, you know, because I mean, I'm not a direct, but I believe that all this culture is all ours, right? I mean, it's all a part of ours. I mean, you know, because in the melting pool, regardless, it's kind of like making stew, right? I might be the carrot. Somebody might say that I'm maybe the chestnut, but in the pot, we're all one. Okay. We all make the flavor of the stew, and that's just what it is. And so everybody's culture seasoned that the way it needed to be. And we're all one. I believe that. So yeah, I can't say that I have direct descendants of any one of these different groups, you know, but the reality of it is I can say that it's a part of the history of the country that I live in. Sometimes it's brutal, sometimes it's unpleasant, but it is part of it. It still ended up making that stew in the end of who we are and what we've become today, and what we're going to be most likely. So I, you know, I love to hear that kind of stuff. I love, you know, for example, I'd let you in on one other little thing they talked about in this book. Now, the ancients believed that when the creator came up the Gila, that he puked on Antelope Hill. And that's what caused the stone to be so coarse. I love that story. That's in there. That's in there. That the creator came up the Gila. He was sick, and then he threw up, puked, whatever, however you want to say it. Probably threw up is probably better. Sorry about that. Puked, but he made the rock course, and that's the story. And I love that story. I think it's a great story. You know, I think it's neat. And so, you know, so I believe that, you know, again, all this history is all ours. I mean, we all got to take some good and some bad. Hari, take care of yourself. Always good, my friend. And thank you very much. I appreciate that. You, and you know, I do. Very knowledgeable cat right there. If you have any questions on any stuff, and he's out of San Diego, but he knows stuff all the way through here as well as there. Right now, I'm talking about stones and spirits right here, Clay. And that's the book that we picked up, that I picked up from John, he picked up from Maria. And I don't know where they got that, or vice versa. One of them got it. I thought it was Maria, but maybe not. The book about Antelope Hill. And so it just basically took one location and just talked about the entire history of this one location of how all of the generations of thousands, not hundreds, thousands of years, right, came through here. And it's incredible. It really is. I mean, it's a credible book. And you know, I'm sure every one of them has it. And again, like I said, I was so excited that, you know, that we've got Archaeology Southwest that we can lean on. And, you know, one of the things I told the guys is I wanted a place to be able to call. You know, if one of us finds something that, you know, we wanted people that we could trust, and I don't trust everybody. And I want to, you know, I want to have somebody that if we find some stuff that to call and we feel comfortable with, you know. And I, after talking with them, I do, you know, and, you know, hopefully the relationship will just expand and it'll get better and better and better. And we can maybe, I would love to do some projects with them. I'd love to go do some of their sites that they have. They got all these different locations, and I know they're fighting for some stuff up near Ernest. I know they're fighting up there for, for areas in his as well. And, you know, they're not just Arizona. They're all Southwest. It's Southwest, right? And even though they're out of Tucson, Agua Caliente town where the children's sect is found. Yes, that is the place where the children of the light is at. And that's an interesting story. You know, the thing about Arizona is so cool is that you can go to a place, and I don't care. Let's take Agua Caliente. It's off the highway past Gila Bend. It's within the Gila Bend area, basically. Not Gila Bend, but the Gila Bend area, I should say. And you can go to a place, and you can pick it, and then you can go there, and then you can read about it, and it's just got all this fabulous, unbelievable information and stuff, and it's got petroglyphs there, and ancients were there because of the hot springs, and then it became a resort because they came there again, just like in the other area I was talking about. So they built a spa there, and then all of a sudden, somehow blasting or something when they were mining, they screwed the water up, so they lost their hot water, some story like that. And then there's a sign that says Children of the Sun. And then I'm like, Children of the Sun? So I think it's Children of the Sun. And so I go study that, and it's a cult, I shouldn't say cult. It's a commune of people that were from Canada that came down for like 30, you know, been there for 30 years in the desert, kind of like a commune in the desert in Agua Caliente, and you know, all kinds of different stuff. I mean, you read these stories and it just goes on and on and on, and you just can be fascinated, you know, by the history. That's why it's so cool about this. This is such a, like a practice, like I said. You're never going to get all of it. And, I'm not going to get everything right either. And the reality of it is that it has so many, you know, facets about it. And, you know, this is just here. I mean, I'm sure Ernest told me stories about Shiprock, which is incredible to me. I mean, again, some of these fascinating stories that I want to bring to life, man. I want to share these stories because they're fascinating, and some of the different cultures and their ways of life and things like that. And hopefully I'll get the opportunity with the knowledge units we have here. I mean, there's so much stuff here. It just goes on and on and on, Who would ever? I mean, I never heard of guys that were a scalping party that was not a scalping party because they were scalping because they were trying to, you know, they were maybe warring and things like that, but just for profit. You know, I never heard of that. I've never heard of that until I got into this. You know, John got into here. He gave me a name. I looked at the name. And, you know, the guy's name is written on the wall here up on one of the petroglyphs on Antelope Hill. And I'm going to go find it. That's the goal, to go up this week sometime. And he was killed. He wrote it. And then he was killed in the same year by Ernest. You won't believe this, Ernest, but he was killed by the Apache. I know you're not going to even believe this if you're still on here, but he was killed by the Apache because he was born with the Apaches. And it's a fascinating story. It's incredible story about what took place and these characters that went through here. And, you know, again, like, you know, I want to, you know, Kino, what a badass. That dude was ridiculous. I mean, how ridiculous is he? I mean, you know, that guy was, you know, you don't think of, you want to think of the, you know, these different guys as being really, really bad. Thanks, Hari. It's always a pleasure, sir. But, you know, you think of these guys that were going through, you know, in the earliest times, and, you know, they could kill him, and you know, he went through, you know, and he had faith or what, however you want to put it. Clay, it's like Missouri, for example. There's hardly any public land, very little. Everybody owns everything. And that's what's nice about Arizona is we have this land. It's nice about New Mexico. It's what's nice about Utah and places like that where we do have this open, the Yumas. Did the Yumas kill him or the Apaches, John? I thought I read they thought it might have been the Apaches. But you might be more accurate than I am. So that's going to disappoint Ernest. So let's just keep the Apaches because I don't want to disappoint Ernest. Ernest wouldn't be impressed with Yumas. Oh, perfect. Yeah, please do. Man, I'd love to see the pictures. Man, I want everybody that's out and about, please post to Black Flag Expedition's Facebook page, please. I mean, I want everybody to. And comment, you know, and let's get interactive on that. I'd love to have that happen. I would love to see that. That would be incredible to be able to see that. I that's what I would like to see. So please do so. And you're all Keno did not get thrown off the cliff. You might be thinking of somebody else. He maybe should have, but I don't think he did. Yeah, give me some good aliens. I love the alien ones. That's awesome. Keno actually died, actually an old man, I believe, in Mexico. You know, believe it or not, through his life. Imagine this, though. So, you know, when I think about this stuff, imagine this real quick. You're in Europe. You get on a wood boat full of horses, and it's not a very big wood boat, right? And you know it leaks, and it's full of rats, right? And you sail from Europe to the New World, the Old World, whatever you want to, you know, New Mexico, wherever, right? But you come across the ocean, right? It's got to be miserable. It has to be miserable. And, you know, if you get a day where the wind ain't blowing, you ain't going anywhere. And so you can imagine how miserable that journey would have been, really. And, you know, that was just the start of your deal, you know? And then you go to, and then you get here. And then you're not done. You just got started. So you had to survive that journey across, and then you had to survive the journey here when you got here, and then the wars that you were battling, whether you were battling Mayans or Aztecs or whatever, right? And then, you know, you were battling natives, and this was your life, and, you know, the hardships of what you would have had to have gone through to be, you know, one of the early, you know, when I say pioneers, the early Jesuits, even the Franciscans who came later. I mean, you know, how incredible was that? So it's incredible that these people, they didn't just survive some of this stuff too. They actually, you know, you look at the cultures that were here, they didn't just survive a lot of it. I mean, they actually, you know, got ahead to a certain degree, because when they started building these structures, and they started building the irrigation. How genius was that? I mean, they were building, you know, they had structures in place, which is ridiculous. Quinchins. You know, I've heard that too, John. But I'm thinking, because I know that he battled some Apaches, so I'll get back in here. You're probably right. You probably looked it up, so I better not say that it wasn't you. But I never even heard of the Quinchins. I'm going to say Quinchins. But... It's 1:57. It's almost time. I want to thank this section. Has been sponsored by Mr. Steve Lines and his 757 or whatever that was. But, man, I appreciate that. You guys have all been awesome. I tell you, I couldn't. The generosity overwhelms me. You know, I don't even know what to say other than, oh, my God, that's awesome. And I appreciate it. I sincerely do. Man. I just appreciate the fact that people are coming on here and watching. I mean, that means a lot to me. Thank you, Don. Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Steve. So it was a discount. Thank you, Maria. Thank you, Todd. And you know, I want to, and Ernest, me and Ernest go way back too. And he's a good man. And to the old friends and the new friends, John D. Dizzle, we go way back itself. And Ethan, I'm glad you came out of the darkness into the light. Clay, I'm glad you came along. I appreciate you guys. And who else do I need? Maria, as always. Android Power Load. Hari, thank you so much. And the Lines Family Trust. I appreciate you guys. Todd, Android, And, you know, you guys are just so awesome. Like I said, I appreciate it. I'm overwhelmed. Bruno, what part of Mexico, Bruno? Where are you at? Where are you at in Mexico? I'm just curious. Hopefully you can hear me, if you can. But I'm glad you tuned in, man. I'm glad you showed up at the end, too. Please, I want everybody to interact. Even if you got to leave, you know, ain't no big deal. You know, I know things got to, you know, life goes on. But I'd love everybody to be on here. I'd like to know everybody. I'd like everybody to get to know everybody. Worldwide, we got to at least Mexico today. And, man, I need to go back to Mexico. I need to get back there one of these days. But Quintero, I don't know. I'll look that up, though, Bruno. But I'm glad you came aboard, man. Thank you very much. Because I would like to open the door to this because, you know, I mean, we might see boundaries to some degree, but the ancients that saw no boundaries. I'd love to go to the pyramids down south. I would love to go do that. Man, you talk about awesome stuff. What history is down there? There's all kinds of cool stuff and unbelievable. We are at the witching hour again. Thanks, everybody. I know I missed somebody, Todd. I know I missed somebody, but everybody, I appreciate. I'm overwhelmed. Thank you very much. You guys are awesome. And we'll call it a day, and we'll get back on this next week. And Ethan, thank you, sir. And man, you guys are awesome. That's all I can say. Thanks again for everybody. Oh, I don't know if I can roll back up here. Well, I'm going to do it. I don't care. I'm going to find them and I'm going to do it. Android Power Load, Hari, Todd, Steve, Paul, Ethan, Don, Darla, Ethan, Steve. I appreciate everything, man. I appreciate all of it. You guys are awesome. I'm going to call it evening. And thanks again. Thanks for joining me. And hopefully we'll continue to grow and become worldwide. Take care of yourself. Stay safe. Hike safe. Be good.